Hey everybody. So a few years ago, I made a video about shooting Instax film and old Kodak instant cameras, but it required making a bunch of these little inserts and then in a dark room or a dark bag, attaching each shot to an insert and then loading them into an old Kodak cartridge all one by one in the dark. It was just super inconvenient. I really wanted to make a 3D printed adapter that could take Instax cartridges directly, and I made a few attempts, some of which were pretty wild, like this one with a little motor and rollers and everything. But I could never get it to work reliably, so I gave up. Fast forward a few years, and now I've got a much better Bamboo Labs 3D printer, and I figured I'd give it another shot. After a lot of trial and error, I finally have a reliable, working, 3D printed Instax adapter for some vintage Kodak instant cameras. So let's get into it. Now, just for a quick history recap, it's the mid-1970s, and Kodak comes out with an instant film system to compete with Polaroid. The technology is similar, but Kodak decides to expose the film from the back, whereas Polaroids are exposed from the front. Anyway, Polaroid sues Kodak for patent infringement and wins, and Kodak discontinues all of its instant film products in 1985. But interestingly, before that happens, Fujifilm decides it too wants to get into the instant film game and copies Kodak's homework. They come out with a line of instant photo products in 1981, and because they licensed the technology from Kodak, it's extremely similar to Kodak's instant film. After Kodak loses its lawsuit, Fuji comes to an agreement with Polaroid, allowing them to continue to sell their instant products in Japan. These are the precursors to Instax film, and is the reason why modern Instax film is compatible with these old Kodak cameras. Speaking of cameras, let's talk about some of them, because it gets a tiny bit complicated. I'm going to separate all of these Kodak instant cameras into two camps, crank ejection and automatic ejection. The cheaper cameras in Kodak's range use this manual crank. You take a photo and wind the handle until the picture ejects. This also cocks the shutter for the next exposure. The more expensive cameras had an automatic ejection mechanism. No need to crank a handle, take a picture, and a little motor does the work for you. The only problem is that almost 50 years later, the gears in the automatic ejection mechanism tend to just disintegrate. Can this be fixed with 3D printing? Maybe, but that's not what this video is about. You see, the crank ejection cameras have a much more robust mechanism and can take a lot more abuse. So these are the only types of cameras I would recommend doing any experimentation with, at least right now. There are two types of cameras within the crank ejection category. The big chunguses, such as the Handle, Handle 2, Pleaser, and of course the Coca-Cola Happy Times camera. Super fun, I definitely want one of those. And then there's the slightly more compact and slightly more complicated EK4, which allows for some manual focus. For the time being, my adapter only works on the larger type cameras. There's some very specific design reasons for this, but basically, even though I tried many times, I haven't been able to get an adapter to work reliably enough to shoot a couple packs in a row without failure on the EK4. But I've shot a ton with the bigger type cameras without issue, so for now, let's just stick with the bigger ones. Complicating things a little further, there's one more slight variation within this type of camera that can make a bit of a difference. So let's talk a little bit about film speed. The original Kodak instant film of the 1970s was ISO 160, but in the 80s they released Kodamatic instant film, sometimes also called trim print film, which was twice as fast with an ISO of 320. Modern Instax film has an ISO of 800, which is just over twice as fast as Kodamatic film was. So if you just throw Instax film in one of these cameras, which are expecting slower film, your results are going to be overexposed. A little over one stop with a Kodamatic camera, and a little over two stops with a regular Kodak instant camera. Luckily, these cameras have an exposure compensation dial, which allows you to brighten or darken the exposure by up to two stops. If you have an older Kodak instant camera, just set it to darken all the way, and your photos will be great, if just slightly overexposed occasionally. So of the crank ejection type cameras, only one model, the Pleaser II, expects the higher ISO Kodamatic film. So if you want to get into this, I would really recommend that camera specifically, because it gives you a little more leeway with exposure. But again, with either camera type, you can get very good exposures. Okay, so now with all that finally out of the way, let's get into the adapter, how it works, and how you can make one. Here's the adapter. It's not very complicated, but let's disassemble it and take a look at the parts. As you can see, it's mostly 3D printed, other than a few springs. This is the picker arm adapter that slides in this channel in the main section. This interacts with the original picker arm inside the camera, which pushes it forward and in turn pushes the top exposure up to the rollers and out of the camera. This piece was especially difficult to design in such a way that it moves freely, but also has tolerances tight enough that it doesn't wiggle around so that only one exposure is pushed out of the camera at a time. This is a little bottom piece that slots into the picker arm adapter and locks it into the channel, keeping it from firing out the back when it springs back. This other piece is a plug for the back of the channel. This is just another way to keep the picker arm from being fired out of the adapter. This is what I used before I designed the bottom piece, so it's totally optional, but I'm including it anyway. Then there are these bits. Assembled, this is a spring tensioner that keeps the exposures pushed up towards the top of the cartridge, which I think is really only needed on the last few shots. Modern Instax cameras have them built into the back door, but the original Kodak cartridge used these springs in the cartridge themselves. So we have this little spring unit that consists of this main piece, these two insert pieces, and then these two springs. All of the plastic parts were printed on a bamboo P1S, but as long as you have a decent printer, you shouldn't have any issues. Most materials should work, just make sure it's black so you don't get any light bouncing around inside the camera. I printed the main section with these supports, which come off very easily. I printed the picker arm adapter in this orientation with these support settings, and the supports come off pretty easily as well. The smaller pieces don't require supports and print very quickly. So, to assemble the main section, the spring goes in the channel first, and then the picker arm adapter slides in after. Then you just slot in the bottom piece and the back plug if you want to. For the spring tensioner, take your springs and place them inside the main piece, and then top that with the insert. If all goes well, this should push in and spring up very easily. And now everything's ready to use. Loading the camera can be done out in the open in subdued light, just like a regular Instax camera. Take a cartridge of Instax Square film and slide it into the adapter. Place it into the open back of the camera so that the film can eject towards the rollers. It only fits in one way. With the camera door still open, balance the spring adapter so that the little springy protrusions line up with the holes in the back of the Instax cartridge when the camera is closed up. And here is where we come to the only issue I've really had with the adapter. Sometimes the dark slide, which is the piece of black, thick cardstock that protects the film from exposure and is the first thing ejected when you load a new cart, it can have difficulty ejecting under the spring tension. I've been able to solve this by opening the back of the camera slightly and then winding until the rollers engage the dark slide, which you can feel. Then I close the camera back up and finish ejecting it. This issue might be solved with a different spring tensioner, but this fix has worked for me every time without affecting any of the subsequent exposures, so I don't really think it's a major issue. But one major thing to keep in mind when taking images is framing. So the sides of the image aren't captured, but it is centered, so it's not too difficult to overcome. However, because of the amount of movement that the picker arm is capable of, the Instax film needs to be placed as close as possible to the rollers, meaning that the top portion of the frame is not captured and it favors the bottom portion. So you need to keep in mind to aim a little bit above where you normally would, especially for subjects that are relatively close, or you're going to cut people's heads off, photographically. Another thing to note is that the vintage flashes that were made to work with these cameras work great, although you may need to play around with the exposure a bit depending on how far away your subjects are. Also, you may be wondering about Instax Mini film. Well, I do have an adapter for Mini film, but I've had reliability issues with it, so for now, I'm only releasing the adapter for Instax Square film. I'll release the other one as well if I ever get it working properly. And that's pretty much it. You're ready to resurrect a very fun old camera from total obsolescence. All of the files and info are in the description, and if you give this a shot, leave a comment and let me know. Or if you have any questions, throw them down there too. And don't forget to subscribe and let me know if you want to see more stuff like this. Okay, thanks for watching. Oh, you're still here, huh? Okay, well, a couple of miscellaneous notes for the real nerds. If you look at a lot of these photos I've taken, you'll notice that in the top corners are a couple of splotchy artifacts. This actually has to do with the amount of pressure that the rollers put on the chemical developer inside the film. When the film is ejected, the rollers pop little pods holding the chemicals under the bottom portion of the frame. Then, as the film is ejected, the rollers spread the chemical goo. But the rollers on the old Kodak cameras sometimes don't apply quite enough pressure to spread the goo evenly over the whole image area, leaving the top corners undeveloped and causing these artifacts. The pressure issue might have to do with the difference in dimensions between the vintage Kodak film and the modern Instax Square film, or it might be because the Kodak film was thicker back in the day, or maybe the goo was more viscous, I don't know. I actually kind of like the imperfection, so I don't mind it very much. And anyway, on the handle type cameras, I haven't found a good way to get into the roller mechanism to do anything about it. However, I have figured out how to get into the roller bits on the EK4 model, and 3D printed an adjustment bracket that applies more pressure on the film, which totally solves the issue. Unfortunately, because the EK4's design is more compact and uses a different arrangement to bounce the image onto the film, there's also a small area on the bottom of the Instax frame that doesn't get exposed at all, leaving this black line. Anyway, if I ever get the EK4 adapter working reliably, I'll make a video about how to take that camera apart and get it all working. Oh, man, you're really still here, huh? Okay, well, for you, a bonus. So, most of these cameras go for very little money on eBay because nobody really wants them. I mean, they really haven't been usable since the early 80s, so it does make sense. But sometimes they're missing the little fold-out crank, especially the cheap ones. This can be annoying, but don't discount a good camera just because it's missing the crank. I've got you covered. Here's a 3D printed handle that fits just perfectly. And if you print it on a textured PEI build plate, it gets this stippled texture that really matches the rest of the camera. I'm really so happy with how this little piece looks and feels. It's a silly small thing, but it's really satisfying when things turn out this well. And to be honest, I might actually like it a little more than the original handle. Oh man, you're still here, huh? Okay, but this is the last bonus segment, really. And also, it's not done yet, so this is just a sneak peek. Okay, so this is a fun little camera, and it does have some exposure controls with a little dial, but it lacks any real manual controls. The lens is fixed focus, and the aperture is more or less fixed as well, so there's not much we can do there. But here you can see I've taken one of these cameras apart and exposed the innards. I've also got this Arduino and hooked up a bunch of wires, and this gives me manual control over the shutter timing. Take a look. It's possible I might even be able to read the internal light meter. The ultimate goal would be to replace the original electronics with an Arduino and package all of this up into the battery compartment with a replacement door and a little display like this. This would allow you to take a meter reading either with the camera or with an external light meter and decide what shutter speed you want to use, including super long exposures. And it could be rechargeable with USB-C. So it's a bit of a work in progress. But if this is interesting to you, let me know in the comments and maybe that'll motivate me to work on it. Okay, that really is it this time. Thanks for watching all the way to the end if you did. All of the files and info can be found in the description. And if you're making one of these, really leave a comment or tag me on Instagram or something and let me know how it's going. Okay, bye.